Good afternoon. Welcome, everyone. To this late, really late slot of the last day, teaching day of the semester, we have with us Padma Maitland. Padma is a PhD candidate in the departments of architecture and South and Southeast Asian studies at the University of California, Berkeley. His research focuses on art and architecture of religious pilgrimage sites in South Asia and the movement of people and ideas between India and the United States. He has served as assistant art director for the Central Renovation Project. He co-edited the Light of the Valley, 15th renovation of the Central Stupa in 2011. He is the founding editor of the architecture journal Room 1000 and has curated several exhibitions, including the Elephant Site, Artful Landfills in South and Southeast Asia. And he is currently the American Institute of Indian Studies Junior Fellow for at the Center for Art and Archaeology in Gurgaon. A very warm applause for Padma. Padma is going to speak on California's Hippie Cosmography, God, Ashby, and the whole earth, and I leave it to him to introduce this topic. Just by way of a small anecdote, we are part of the older team who first came to Nalanda for a conference, which was in the January of 2014, if I remember correctly. So me, Padma, Abhiram, Abhishek, and Murari, we were part of that whole conference group. So it's very nice to be able to let Padma back amongst us. Thank you. Thank
you. Well, it's a pleasure to be here, as you said, I think it's a reunion of sort, and it's fun to see the institution growing. What I'm going to talk about today is not what I'm researching at the moment, but something I thought would be fun as it brings together religion and ecology, and also my own background in as I'm from California. So today I'm going to be talking about an ecological sensibility that grew out of the 1950s, 60s, and 70s in California, and the counterculture there. At the end of the talk, I'm hoping to ask you guys what an Indian counterculture is and how that pairs up against California counterculture. But I thought, again, Nalanda has such a history of people coming from around the world, and particularly in the 50s and 60s and 70s, you had this group of hippies and religious tours coming, and that they brought back to California all these ideas of, you know, Buddhism, Hinduism, Jainism, and those influenced design practices at the time and ecological thinking at the time. But what I also want to stress is that it wasn't just hippies and religious pilgrims; it was also designers, scientists, technocrats who were also coming to India in the 50s and 60s, and they also were kind of part of this amalgamation of new ideas and approaches. So I'll be highlighting that today. I will read a little bit just in the beginning to get us going, and then at the end again, and in the middle I'll be more informal. Okay. And can everybody hear me? I have a tendency to talk quite quickly. Great. So, it was a time of eclectic images, of new and varied cultures coming together, of drugs, alternative modes of transcendence inspired by Eastern philosophy, and unprecedented surpluses of goods. It was a time of disillusionment, too, of seething dissatisfaction with the status quo, and later, anger and frustration over denied promises, the advent of cold and silent wars, and impending environmental disasters. The repurposing of war machines and factories towards consumerism went hand in hand with the refurbishing of youth consciousness and expanding local perspectives, stimulated by airplane travel, new media, and rapid cross-cultural exchanges and conflicts. California was at the forefront of these new avant-garde, the next frontier for expanding creative potential that ran from computer-aided design, art, film, music, to mind-altering substances, yoga, and meditation. The state of California, sometimes known as the California state of mind, has long been a bastion for explorers and dreamers, home not only to major aerospace research centers and naval bases, but also Hollywood, communes, and countless religious centers, both new and old, especially those from India, Tibet, and Japan. If it wasn't the radical spiritualism of Scientology, then it was the revamped models of Hinduism exemplified by the Vedanta Society and the Self-Realization Fellowship, the Zen practices of Suzuki Roshi, the Tibetan Buddhism of Shambhala, or return to first principles of Native American traditions, By 1945, the multiple missions of these multiple influences began to inform each other, resulting in new design innovations and sensibilities. By the 1970s, it converged as a new ecological sensibility. The whole Earth catalog, first published in 1969 by Stuart Brand, was an influential venue for new ecological thought, formed through the assemblage of sundry references. In its large newsprint pages, sold for a dollar, you could find everything from geodesic domes, teepees, the I Ching, guides for composting, and esoteric diatribes. Between goods for sale were featured essays and editorials sent in by readers on topics loosely assembled into thematic groups such as ecology, shelters and such, and tools and techniques. Often cited as a halfway point between a mail order catalog and the internet, the Whole Earth catalog ostensibly catered to people who had quit the city to live off the grid, or readers interested in a heterogeneous take on world cultures and saving the planet. There are several genesis stories for the Whole Earth catalog. The most famous is Stuart Brand, who got the idea to start the catalog while flying across the United States. Brand had been running a nationwide pin campaign with the slogan, "Why haven't we seen a picture of the whole Earth yet?" The campaign began in response to rumors that NASA had taken a picture of the Earth from space, but hadn't released it. And Brand argued that it would be an image to change the world, one to contrast the atomic bombs image of the big mushroom cloud a year before. So if the atomic bombs image was to show the world being destroyed, Earth from space was an image to kind of show the world to be saved. For Brand, the image of the whole Earth from space was graphically stunning, embodying both the fragility of the globe, a small blue and green speck in an otherwise vast expanse of space, and the commonality of a shared world. If the power of the mushroom cloud was to suggest a new ability to completely destroy the Earth, the picture of the whole Earth from space showed the Earth's precarity and our need to respond collectively to save it. Brand used a picture of the Earth from space as the iconic cover of the first Whole Earth catalog. In successive issues of the catalog, the globe would be taken up as a graphic element appearing as an oversized volleyball in one issue and as a repeated graphic forming a cosmic fractal in another. Another origin story of the catalog is from the office of Gordon Ashby, an influential designer in San Francisco Bay Area. Ashby helped establish the program in design at San Francisco Art Institute, and it was there that he met Stuart Brand. When Ashby began work on a museum exhibition called Astronomia, sponsored by IBM for the Hayden Planetarium in New York, he hired Brand to photograph objects for the exhibit. The antique almanacs he photographed caught Brand's attention, and one day Brand told Ashby, "Well, what we need today is an almanac for this generation," thus the Whole Earth catalog, an almanac for the counterculture. The true origin of the Whole Earth catalog is undoubtedly a combination of influences, of varied experiences, and the right opportunity to launch a radical venture. But Brand needed help producing it, so he went to Ashby's office to help with that. But it wasn't until 1971 that Ashby had the chance to kind of create his own issue. Find Your Place in Space was a special insert within the Whole Earth catalog dedicated to presenting global and universal principles for ecology and personal transformation. Ashby's set of mandalas for the Find Your Place in Space insert exemplify a longer history of symbols appropriated for new cultural expressions in the United States, in California in particular. If mind-altering drugs offered one way of reconsidering one's place in space, transcendental meditation and religious symbolism offered another. However, it was not just these two trends that informed Ashby's graphic language. While they may have provided the impetus for the designs, it was Ashby's background in new trends and display as an immersive experience and as a means to represent abstract connections that helped crystallize his countercultural aesthetic, linked to making the unseen seen and diagramming as a way to make the complex intuitive. Ashby's practice was exemplary of graphic sensibilities of the era. He pushed the principles of design forward in order to define and advocate for an ecological perspective grounded in the countercultural movement's experiment with alternative visions of the whole. He was the abstract diagram as an invitation to participate, and the mandala as a form to hold multiple references while prioritizing a first-person experience. Okay, so now we're going to leave California and move back in time to Europe, and to kind of the start of the infographic movements in Vienna. And we'll come back to California, but I think it's important to understand these graphic approaches in order to understand where Gordon Ashby is coming from in his approach. Okay. So, several decades before Gordon Ashby, and before Stuart Grant's Muller catalog, we have Otto Neurath, pioneer of the logical positivism and a member of the Vienna Circle. He was head of several museums, including the Museum of War Economy and Museum of Town Planning, and the Social and Economic Museum. And he wanted to experiment with new ways of visualizing information that could be standardized to kind of, as he would put it, share with the masses how the world worked, and so that they could work to fix it. So he developed something with his wife, Marie Nura, a program called Isotype, and here you see his book, From Hieroglyphics to Isotype. And it was this amazing process of taking data, information about cities, making sense of it, and then turning it into graphic imagery that could be clearly and kind of instantly understood. The kind of key player of the Isotype program was somebody called the Transformer, and their role in the office was to take data and figure out how to present it graphically. And once that had happened, it could kind of be put into Isotype lexicon. So a lot of time was actually spent figuring out what the figure of the Isotype person should look like. And I thought this was important to show, mostly because it shows, you know, they wanted something standard, but also something that could show kind of the diversity of the world. So in here, you know, it's how you show the diversity of cultures and people, whatever. Take of it what you will, here's that attempt. So Isotype actually, you know, with the wars, they flew first to Amsterdam, where they were for several years, and then with the Second World War, they actually shifted to London. And once they shifted to London, they kind of joined with a group of other designers that had kind of escaped from Bauhaus and wherever, and then the ideas, not necessarily all of them, went to America and to New York, East Coast and those places, to kind of develop new strategies there. So just here, I thought, this is examples of Isotype, right? So you have this basic figure of the person that then gets multiplied to show graphically, you know, demographics, car usage. I think now we take it quite for granted, you know, you see this. But at the time, it was quite radical, the idea that you could show somebody how much oil was being used by a city as a basis for understanding, you know, your individual use in conversation with kind of population's use of that idea. That's a basic, like a good. So one figure in America who really picks up the Bauhaus ideas and kind of unites it with Isotype is Herbert Bayer. And he's a wonderful designer who brings together an interest in peace and an interest in ecology in America. And his most kind of well-known symbol is the recycling symbol. The idea that you could see a cycle of exchange, production, reproduction. So this is his legacy. But in 1953, he produced something else called the World Geographic Atlas, which combined Isotype standards with other cutting-edge design strategies to create atlas that presented the world as a composite environment. The World Geographic Atlas is an atlas of dense ecologies, saturated with diagrams and illustrations of shipping routes, migration paths, seismic events, and global weather patterns. It also dives into specific countries to map in detail their plant life, roads, social customs, and local terrains. And I think it's interesting, you're sponsored by the Container Corporation of America, so there was definitely an interest just to show the movement of goods around the world. The key to the geographic atlas was a composite for man's environment, a sort of Venn diagram around a central figure that represents the multiple spheres of influence that define human environments. And I think it's important that it's not just, you know, it's not just trees and water, it's astronomy, climatology, economics, all of these things come together to define the environment. And I think that's really a shift at this point that happens, to think about the environment as something culturally, as also in terms of, you know, natural products, but also culture and money, and all of these things coming together to form a man's composite environment, as it were. But while the geographic atlas was an exploration in two dimensions, Bayer was deeply interested in three dimensions, and he had these interesting display tactics and approaches to creating immersive environments. So this is from his book on display, and you can see, like, he's thinking about what happens if you put, you know, boards and illustrations all around a person. What is the experience of that person? How do they understand information differently? These grew out of an earlier exploration in 1943, so just, you know, during World War II. And it was an exhibition for the Museum of Modern Art in New York, called Airways of Peace. The show was premised on the idea that air travel unified the world through the creation of global airspace. So again, this kind of doubling of peace and war. So the same technology that made World War possible, the kind of rampant air travel, they were suggesting could now become a way of uniting the world, a suggestion of a world united by global air travel. In the exhibit, a series of globes and maps highlight different ways of visualizing the Earth. One globe, for example, was made of transparent plastic with a mirror placed on the opposite side. Looking at any point on the globe, one inevitably saw the point on the other side. To see California, therefore, was also to see India. That's that globe there. The centerpiece of the exhibit, though, was a world turned inside out. And I have trouble explaining why I think this is so exciting, but we never think about the world that way, right? We always see the world looking out. And, you know, a long time ago, that meant people thought the world was flat. But if you see the world from the inside, you see it as a singular space that you can occupy, and you see yourself in it. And I think this was a huge moment for Bayer in this kind of time period to think of the world as something you occupy, that are your inside, and you have a role in kind of animating through your presence there. Another person playing with domes and globes at the time, was, or just a little bit later, was Buckminster Fuller, a rather quirky guy I think who got kicked out of Harvard twice. In 1943, together with a do-it-yourself guide, Life magazine featured Fuller's The Dynaxium World, but it was Fuller's geodesic domes, premised on the same spherical trigonometry, that were most widely adopted. Like his Dynaxium World, Fuller's domes formalized an image of Earth as a unified whole. It also suggested the possibility of microsystems and microecologies existing within and separate from larger superstructures, subprocesses and eddies that could work together to create composite realities. Rather than one Earth or one reality, Fuller argued for an understanding of the Earth as a self-regulating system, much like a spaceship hurtling through space with all life on board. And in 1969, he actually published an operating manual for spaceship Earth. And so if you think about that Bayer image of the Earth that you didn't have it, Fuller kind of takes that idea one step further and says, well, actually, you can create Earth anywhere. You know, you can create it on a small scale, on a big scale. And, you know, we have space traveling happening at the moment, so you're thinking of colonies and other planets, and actually this dome gets picked up as biodome, so it's kind of recreations of the world's ecosystems used Fuller domes. Other designers in California, so now we're finally coming back to California. So Fuller's domes really get kind of picked up and married with you know, certain, actually, so interestingly enough, Fuller gets picked up by all sorts of figures. So he gets picked up on the one hand by kind of the Department of State, the US Department of State, by military operations. So the first use of Fuller domes is for kind of anti-air raid stations, because they can be deployed cheaply, quickly, easily, helicopter can drop it in, but also for American expos in other countries. So here's the 1959 World Expo in Moscow. So the outside, you can see the kind of big geodesic dome. And on the inside, you have a series of seven screens showing life in America. And so this new world, this kind of mini microcosm of America, is brought over to Moscow to show, at that time, kind of what the, how great American life was. But you also get the geodesic dome taken up by hippies and countercultures in the West Coast, and particularly by communes who decided to drop out of the mainstream culture. So here you have a city called Drop City, and they've kind of just abandoned, they've gone off the grid basically, and they've taken the geodesic dome as their form of habitation. New centers of culture and experimentation were popping up everywhere, and dome architecture became an icon of communities attempting to find new holistic forms. The geodome, the mandala, the circle, all became diagrams for ideal communities and harmonious approaches to life, and all were featured in the Whole Earth Catalog. So if you remember, the Whole Earth Catalog was one of the biggest ways of you could buy kind of kit of parts to make a geodesic dome for yourself. And the Whole Earth Catalog was designed specifically for, if not always used by, people who dropped out. Okay, so now we finally are in California with the two famous designers, Ray and Charles Eames, who actually came to India at the end of the 1950s. So Gordon Ashby, the guy who kind of started this paper, his formative design years were spent in the office of Ray and Charles Eames. Known for their eclecticism and playful quality, the Eameses were in many ways the inheritors of infographic tradition begun in Europe and then practiced by Bauhaus modernists in the United States, people like Bayer, etc. Their projects ranged in scale from iconic furniture to film to architecture. Drawing from the latest trends in graphics and design, the young hip aesthetic of their work introduced a new, more playful openness to design in America. It was light, it was colorful, it was open, it was cheap. India and the circus were important references within the Eames office, the surface, much like Fuller geodesic domes, exemplified the ideal of an expandable space that could hold whatever kind of magical world could be imagined, from elephants to trapeze artists, all buzzing with life. The impact of India on Indian design philosophy is manifold, but perhaps best summarized by the Vipanali parable, which is a parable that Ray Eames rather liked to talk about, which was that earliest man gave up of banana leaves, and then eventually the leaf became a clay plate, and then it became a metal plate, and then it became a silver plate, and then it became a gold plate. But the best person, according to Eames, was the one who could eat off a gold plate but decided to eat off the banana plate. And this was a parable that actually came directly out of his travels to India. The other idea that came out of India or kind of influenced countercultural design studies was this notion of play. And I think it's quite kind of a ludic, playful approach to work. So the counterculture is well known for, I think now we, the offices in Google, the kind of easy offices, open offices where everybody's casual and eating cereal and having a good time. Those grew out of an idea of office culture that work is something you love, that work is your life, it's not just something that's 9 to 5. But I'd like to argue that actually, I think the notion of play has more connotations in the counterculture, and particularly from India. And a major reference actually is Krishna, and this idea of the Krishna Lila, Krishna's playground, and the world that you kind of are dancing and playing within. But also the idea that there's some kind of divine essence to play, that play is creative, that it's not just something static, but actually through play you generate something, whether it's a feeling, whether it's a world, whether it's a relationship. And this is a post-pensive. Krishna actually was a rather rampant figure in the countercultural aesthetic of California. This is a poster by the well-known East Totem West Company showing Krishna. But also you had party Krishnas kind of running around Berkeley and San Francisco. And they actually adopted some of the same, they took some of the countercultural design aesthetics and brought them into their own publication. So you really have a Hare Krishna publication, bringing in kind of the trippier psychedelic images that you see on more countercultural paraphernalia. But I hope if this trajectory makes sense, you have the kind of early Bayer dome, the people come inside, and you have Fuller saying you can fill that dome with mini earths, and then you have the ludic, playful people, the Eames coming in and saying you can make that world magical through play, you can make it something extraordinary. And that's kind of brings us back to the TRIPS Festival. So the TRIPS festivals were in California in the 60s, and TRIPS is a reference, of course, to drugs, to tripping, but it's also, these were called sometimes B and TRIPS Fest, and there were invitations for people to come together and experiment with new ways of being together, of being in the world. There was light shows. Gordon Ashby would come with something called the light matrix. Basically, it was a machine, it was basically a slide projector that had images of dots, and he would project it over the audience, and people would dance while having their kind of body covered with dots. All that's exciting, but more interesting was actually, when I talked to Gordon Ashby, what he talked about was that it was the first moment that people understood other people were feeling the way they were feeling. To make sense, it was a sense, there's a lot happening with the Vietnam War, with all of these things, people were feeling sad, they were feeling frustrated, but also feeling a lot of excitement. And they also felt very alone until they started having festivals like this. And then suddenly they realized there's other people thinking and feeling okay. So that's an important part of the story. Okay, so Gordon Ashby, the kind of late hero of this talk, was enmeshed in the California counterculture. If it was cool and radical in the 1960s and 70s, he was there, usually camera in hand, or with his famous light matrix, projecting abstract patterns onto swarming bodies at B-ins, acid tests, and trip festivals, all of which he performed at and also helped to arrange. Under his self-assumed identity of the transformer, Ashby impacted the fields of education, exhibition design, graphic design, and later the environmental movement. His 1971 mandalas for the Whole Earth catalog embodied all of these pursuits to create a holistic picture of man's place in space, the body plugged in, not just into electronics, but into universal ebbs and flows, and spiritual images from India had a role to play in forming this new vision. So when Gordon Ashby left the Eames office to set up his own practice in San Francisco in the 1960s, he joined a growing group of designers and radicals who had moved north to be part of the scene there. Like the Eames office down south, Ashby's place at 9 on 84 Vanderwater quickly became a hub of designers and innovators, he's well known for his candlelight lunches, when he would invite a bunch of kind of anybody he thought interesting to kind of come. And his office was always open, so that was another aspect. His office door was always open, and anybody could actually come in. And actually had a lot of famous photographers and people who would come in and use his studio for photograph, you know, photo shoots, or who would just walk in and start painting, because he had these huge rolls of paper set up in his office, and people could just come in and do whatever. So I think that was part of his ethos at the time. And he moved from San Francisco when he felt it was no longer safe to keep his door open. But Gordon Ashby was best known as a museum guy. So as I said at the beginning, he had done this astronomy exhibit. In the Eameses, he had done several pavilions for IBM, showing technology, the history of technology, the history of math. But in Oakland, in California, his most famous or most innovative exhibition design was the Hall of Ecology for the Oakland Museum of California. These pictures don't really do justice, but what was so innovative was that he demanded that they break down divisions. So normally you have like a house of reptiles, a house of snakes, oh, that's the same, the house of, you know, whatever, different disciplines. He said, no, we're going to have one hall, and it's going to show all of California as if you walked across California. So what would your experience be walking from one side of California to the other? And I'm going to show you the different ecologies you'll move through in that process. There's no humans pictured in the exhibit. The human is the person walking through the exhibit. And it was just a really radical way of showing an ecology as something that you move through, as something that's integrated but still has its parts. So it's this constant combination of a whole system with miniature parts within it that I think he really picks up with in his mandalas. Okay, mandalas. Maybe you guys know about mandalas, but I'm going to tell a little bit about them anyway. So, mandalas. They refer to circles. Or a more expanded understanding of them is an abstract representation of spheres of power and influences as diagrams of cosmic order and divine abodes. Mandalas are a common motif throughout Asia, visible in the plans of Borobudur, Angkor Wat, and the murals of China and Tibet, ancient scrolls of Japan, and temples in India. They are used by different religious traditions, including Jainism, Buddhism, and Hinduism. While the mandala would come to be read as an archetype, a form exemplary of the basic conditions of existence, and thus a universal symbol that could be found in many traditions. By the 1950s in America, mandalas were a Tibetan thing. Because many scholars in Europe and America learned about Buddhism and Hinduism at the same time, the history of Indian and Tibetan mandalas are linked in the scholarship of figures like Giuseppe Tucci. Following on the footsteps of wanderers like Lama Govinda or Theos Bernard, Tucci traveled extensively throughout Asia and wrote about Buddhism and Hinduism based on what he learned and experienced there. His most famous book, The Theory and Practice of the Mandala, published in Italian in 1949 and then in English in 1961, was for many years the definitive text on mandalas in the West. For Tucci, mandalas are a support for training, a guide for complex visualizations and initiations. As a sacred diagram towards auto-consciousness, the mandala points to the underlying patterns that govern universal experience and wholeness. They are also diagrams of prime and universal truths, archetypes for realities believed to transcend cultural, religious, and historical differences. As Tucci writes, quote, the mandala is a geometric projection of the world reduced to an essential pattern, end quote. The structure of a mandala is dynamic. It represents a moment of equilibrium in a process of disintegration and reintegration, when things are in balance and the multiple parts of existence are imagined to have been brought into order. Okay. I think nobody's had a bigger impact on how the West, you know, Americans and Europeans think of mandalas than Carl Jung. And his philosophy of mandalas was very interesting, mostly because it prioritized this notion of individuation, which is bringing the self back into harmony with itself and the world. And so maybe mandala is a highly personal thing, a highly individual thing. And for years, he drew a mandala every day. And actually, when I met people who had kind of got it, you could do courses on how to do Jung mandalas. And there were years and years, like they would go for years, and would every day draw a mandala, or draw a circle. And then you would meet with your therapist and talk about it. What does it mean? What does it mean to have a snake in one corner? What does it mean to have a snake in the other? And through that process of drawing and talking about it, you would kind of bring some sense of harmony to yourself and yourself, your place in the world. And I think this idea of the mandala is really carried through. One of my favorite quotes by somebody who actually went through one of those courses was, she said, you know, we drew so many circles, by the end of the program, I didn't know if I was a circle anymore or not. So she kind of felt that she had turned herself into a circle through the process of drawing it. So but by the 1970s, this idea that the mandala is an individual process of exploration had really taken off and been explored by all sorts of artists and creative types. And this countercultural approach to the mandala was synthesized or best presented by Jose and Miriam and Aguayas, who wrote this book, Mandala, which basically was usually on the shelf. Almost anyone you went into in California, especially any intellectual artist, they would have three books on their shelves probably. The Tibetan Book of the Dead, the I Ching, and this book on mandalas. And interestingly enough, Carl Jung wrote introductions to most of those. But here you see again this kind of exploration of the mandalas and impersonals. The book is filled with mandalas from all over the world, but also mandalas drawn by Jose and Miriam. And the other thing that I think is really striking is the appearance of a body within the mandalas. So a lot of mandalas leave the subject unrepresented. It's not shown. If it is, it's a kind of divine deity. But the idea is that it's kind of an invitation to enter or suggestive of a visualization practice, a ritual that you engage in. Here, in these mandalas, you're really showing the body being transformed by taking on a series of mandalas within the body at different chakras, and it kind of uniting different traditions and approaches from Carl Jung's alchemy to other processes of kind of cities and transformations and yogas and things like that. Okay. In our essay on the idea of the mandala as a governing device, Sonit Bhanfa argues that scholars in the United States and Europe exaggerated the role of the mandala as a generative diagram. While that may be the case, in the context of California counterculture, the mandala was understood to be a governing device that could be generative of new forms and new ways of seeing. It could be used as a tool for guiding design, graphics, as well as personal explorations for new ways to connect with and participate in principles of unity and wholeness. Architects, artists, and writers were all finding ways to incorporate mandalas into their work, either suggestively through basic geometric similarities, or conceptually through organizing material around a strong center. Countercultural mandalas were more than mirrors of spiritual influences from Asia or appropriated foreign symbols. They became part of a lexicon or archetype for post-war society and a form to embody novel beliefs in an interconnected world. This new vision was as inspired by Eastern philosophies as by the advent of air travel and new pictures of the Earth from space. So I guess if you guys can come along with me, what we're going to do is bring these two interests of mandalas and infographics, and I'm going to hope to show how they kind of work in Gordon Ashby's mandalas for the whole Earth catalog. Gordon Ashby drew seven mandalas for the Find Your Place in Space issue of the Whole Earth catalog. In addition, he made a fractal design for the cover with a series of whole Earths forming a ring around the central orb with the graphic of the transformer in the core. The mandalas comprise a spatial insert in the edition related to the theme. The front page of the insert is a riff on the catalog standard cover. Instead of the Whole Earth catalog, it reads Always the Whole Thing catalog. The switch from Earth to Thing marks a transition from the individual globe to a more inclusive super system. The whole now, as an idea, is presumed to be both scaleless and timeless. This new space is illustrated by a framed view of a galaxy seen from a distance. A series of line drawings of the sun, moon, and stars frame the galaxy. The illustrations are reminiscent of early cartographic conventions when the larger natural forces were anthropomorphized into animated details. Below, the main image reads, Finding Your Place in Space. The title typeface, black on white, is conspicuously not filled in all the way. Instead, it is left stenciled in, as if to suggest that the front cover is a window onto a dynamic cosmos beyond the first page of black and white spots, like those of the swirling galaxy at the center. The cover view of the galaxy is striking in its symmetry. It is also an impossible view of the universe, seen in plan as if from above, centered amidst a circle of black space. If seeing the world from space was a new way of understanding our place in the world, this image expands that vision, suggesting a much larger cosmology. Like the famous Eames film, Power of Ten, it expands the picture of the universe by several orders of magnitude. The spiraling arms of the galaxy suggest both its immensity and dynamism. considering how the image of the galaxy was made, what new technologies and abilities made it possible to take an image of a universe and then paste it in a catalog, gives us a clue to the meaning of the words drafted in the bottom of the page. We are as gods and might as well get on with it. These are the opening words of the Whole Earth Catalog. Actually, they're play on the opening words of the Whole Earth Catalog, which are, we are as gods and might as well get good at it. And here we've kind of taken on that role and said we might just get on with life as gods. Written carefully between two intentionally drawn parallel lines, the words read like a dictum, contrasting to the much looser freehand script used elsewhere as guides and poetic inspiration. As a basis for understanding our new place in space, the whole thing, catalog insert, goes on to link space with totalizing experience. Next to a diagram of a black circle with the infinity sign in the middle, it reads, "The universe is everything." The text goes on to describe the different scales of things that make up everything. The Milky Way, the solar system, the Earth, animals, plants, insects, are all part of the universe. And then finally, you, are part of the universe. These diverse elements make up the stuff of experience and arise out of space. As the next page informs the reader, this stuff is one thing, it's complete. It is the basis for human experience and all of the moving parts, and all of the moving parts together are what make up the whole thing. Our place in space is not separate, but integral to everything. The flames of the infinity mandala drawn on the left page of the insert spread out onto the opposite page, bathing one mandala in the rays of light from the other. The vision expands. Each complete integrated experience impacts the other. The focus of the page, a large collage circle, with another strong black line circumscribing it. At the center of the image is a picture of the Earth from space. Around the Earth are bodies densely packed, all sitting and looking in towards the center. One more ring out are collage images of birds, animals, insects, and shells, all at different scales, and rivers, forests, and lakes, before a final set of rings. First one white ring, then a thick black one, like the bounding limit of the Earth's atmosphere. The world is one giant cosmic mandala. Each Earth thing is involved in a vast and complex system of sharing the energy of the sun. As part of this collage, we do our part and keep our promise. When asked about its mandalas, Ashby explained that they provide a way to give form to the way we were feeling about things, to break away from a linear perspective and provide multiple layers within a single form. An acid trip, he said, is like that. The next mandala find your place in space are of the Earth from space and what appears like a psychedelic depiction of microorganisms and cellular structures. Mind-altering drugs were an influential step in America towards understanding experience as a mandala. And the stylized shapes and colors combining to create comedic and colorful forms is referenced in this graphic. LSD was a window into seeing the Earth as interconnected, and mandalas offered both an enticing image to view while tripping, but also an iconic image to reflect on the experience afterwards. They offered a compelling image of the immersive experience of being godlike in the center of an always expanding cosmic reality at play. According to Gordon Ashby, like the other outputs of the counterculture, mandalas were based on drug-induced experiences, but not just that. They drew on and built upon ideas of connection and interrelation described by physics, philosophies from India, and trends in infographics. Physics was also exploring new dimensions of time and space, and these two had a role to play in Ashby's mandalas. Between the two spheres of Earth and the microorganisms featured in one of Ashby's mandalas, the phrases, "creation is the stuff of time, time is the stuff of the universe," are written. Nine circles surround the central clover, unfolding a process of coming and falling out of order, of dots that read as stars that become clusters, then isolated clusters before becoming the base elements of the structures of the microorganisms. This mandala, composed of a set of smaller mandalas, is enclosed by a surface of hand-drawn shrubs and flowers. The flowers sprout up from the starry universe at the center of the great circle, forming the surface of the globe. A group of bees fly down to the one flower, crowding its stamen. Along the bottom of the circle, a group of small figures with wings, or perhaps a sequence showing one figure with wings, attempt to fly up to the flower and then fall down, recalling the myth of Icarus's ascent to the sun. The allegory of reaching too high comes at an interesting moment in the insert. After positing our roles as the gods, the illustrations warn us against forgetting our place in the world, to be godlike, or really more pertinently, to be human is to understand our limits as much as our potential. The major subtheme of find your place in space is responsibility. It is not just about locating oneself, but about accepting the responsibility of humans within the larger scheme of things. During the late 1960s and early 70s, Ashby took on the role of transformer, a kind of radical education program that went to schools and universities across the country. He would kind of dress in crazy clothes with a top hat and whatever. And he had two games he liked to play. With children particularly, he liked to take a parachute, and he would form a circle, and everybody would grab a hold of it, and you'd run as far away from each other as you could, and then you'd run towards each other, throwing the fabric into the air. And what happens is you create a dome, and then you kind of all sit down on top of the fabric, and you create a kind of space. And the idea was that together they could create a new space. The other game he liked to play was to bring a rabbit to every show. So you bring a rabbit, and everybody would play with it, and feed it, and whatever. And then when it was time to go, somebody would come and try and give the rabbit back to him and say, here's your rabbit. And he'd say, nope, it's not my rabbit anymore, it's yours. If it lives, it dies, it's up to you. And so who knows what happened, but the idea was that you're trying to show that you're responsible for life, and this is now your responsibility. So I think that was his point. It was a really quirky experiments in teaching responsibility, I guess. So this is his advertisement for the transformer. It was printed on oatmeal paper, so you could eat the advertisement if you wanted. But basically, you see four figures basically modeled after poor Ashby's figure himself, with his kind of hair, 1970s hair, poofed out. But I think what's important is that you see a person under transformation. And it's a person who's at the beginning isolated on his own, and then by the end integrated into this kind of mandala of all of life. And this is the process of transformation he's really trying to demonstrate in both his education programs, but also his mandalas. The transformation phase one mandala is the final mandala of the find your place in space. It brings the four male figures closer together. It is hard not to read them as Ashby's silhouette, tall with tufts of hair around his head, so that they fill only the upper half of the circle. The two halves of the mandala, man on top and cycles of the moon on the bottom, suggest a parallel between universal and human life cycles. Together they create a greater circle, a cosmic diagram of sorts, showing the universe and the self combined into one diagram of auto-consciousness. So the point I'm trying to make is that Gordon Ashby's mandala show two things. One, an interest in the internalized process of transformation that was really came through with the mandalas. The idea that you could kind of improve yourself through engaging with art and through practice and transformative modes of being. And second, kind of this constantly expanding global vision of the world as a sphere. And he's really taking that to its limit to think about the universe and thinking about the human experience, that personal individual transformation in terms of the cycle of the universe. First the world, first your local, first the world, then the galaxy, then the universe, etc. And I think his use of mandalas is a way to take one image to show that entire process, both interior and exterior, in one graphic. After these kind of inserted mandalas, there's a series of graphic stills that present a dialogue between the announcer, presumably the person advocating the position of the transformer. And in phase one, a middle position between the two, the old and the new, is offered. Religion, politics, and psychology continues to fail us. The dialogue goes on to advocate for change, ecology, and an ageless way of engaging with nature. At crucial moments, voices of dissent call out, one from the regular American and the other from the third world. Caught between the pressures of established order and developing countries, the transformer answers back, we are all in this together. The solution must be integrative, gradual, and holistic. Salvation is unity and age is in unity, in the age-old concept of brotherhood with the earth. We are all born of Mother Nature, he says. Prevailing systems must be burned down. Tibetan mandalas often feature a ring of fire on their outermost circle. The first ring one has to pass through to enter into the center. The flames are symbolic of transformation and purification. Ashby's mandalas tend to reflect the moment after fire, when patterns are restored and the earth starts to bloom again. They are pastoral, visions of flowers, birds, bees, and human beings integrated back into the system, a map for a place in space. We're just about there. So this is an advertisement written by the Transformer for another catalog, for another issue of the catalog. So this story, as told, leaves much still to be considered. It leaves unexamined the role of psychedelics in appreciation of mandalas. Furthermore, it fails to account for the deep history of Indian spiritualism in California and the important role of Native Americans. The first Hindu temple in America was founded by the Vedanta Society in San Francisco in 1893. In 1920, Yogananda established a self-realization fellowship in Los Angeles. These figures represent early examples of a new cosmopolitanism related to Eastern religions and their establishment in the West. In the 1960s, Maharishi Mahesh Yogi became an international sensation through his association with the Beatles, itself leading to a kind of countercultural reformation through the adoption of Indian ideas. But the Maharishi was actually already well known for having traveled the world 8 times. And I think his fame was as much about representing this new idea of global space through travel in the world as for his religious ideas. Such fame in the new use of religious practices and iconography from Asia and the West was more than Orientalist appropriation. It was the ready discovery of ideas and concepts that found synergy at the time with research and advances in technology and the sciences, informing a particular countercultural way of seeing the world. In the 1971 issue of the Whole Earth Catalog, there is a page of text signed "The Transformer." He writes about how the problem with ecological thinking is people's failure to consider the results of their manner of living. A failure to understand life as a process that turns and turns. In order to bring the world back into balance, the Transformer writes, quote, "We need to develop a national ecological consciousness. We need to come to terms with our desires and the implications of them." Next to the text written in careful and cursive is a body of veins and arteries. They form not of skin, muscle, and skeleton, but of circulatory tracts and connections. At the toes, the veins extend out along the pages, becoming first branches and then wheat. Such graphics call to mind, graphics and calls to action gave way to a series of architectural visualizations of houses as organic living systems with inputs and outputs that could be calibrated. These take the idea of the individual as something kind of integrated back into the world and now apply it to the individual home as something part of a larger system and the need to balance our kind of individual dwellings in order to balance the larger ecology of the world. A transformer is someone who takes on the mission to reform his or her relationship to the earth, to understand it as integrated. It is someone who considers their interior and exterior engagements as symptomatic of global processes to arrive at a more integrated experience of nature with the ecology of the whole, and then tries to share that vision with others. In the end, it is not about one vision of the world, but about multiple visions. Of personal and intuitive paradigms coming together to form new, more global ones, a great circle perhaps, or a vision of the world, like a mandala transformed. And finally, Ashby still is alive, or Ashby, he still lives in Northern California, still an avid environmental activist. And two things that he did after closing his design shop were basically he organized with the small community he lives in to buy back all of their water rights. So, I guess water is either owned by the government or by corporation, and he didn't like that. So he made the entire town buy the water rights so that they are in charge of how much water they use and how much it should cost and all of that. The other thing was to create a huge land trust in the area, so buying up huge amounts of land so that nobody could build on it. And he actually did that in conversation with the Vedanta Society, which also helped buy up a lot of that land. So again, this kind of merging of kind of different forms of ecology, you know, different approaches to ecology, whether it's religious, scientific, whatever, around ecology in California. So I'll end it there.
So for this very, very exciting presentation and sharing your research with us, the way it connects, I mean, it's a good way to end the semester, I think, because it connects both our present schools and some of the concerns that we are engaged with as a university community at the moment. And that's one of the reasons why we thought this might be both the schools of historical study and school of ecology and environment studies. Thought that it might be a good way to round up our semester with. And I'll now make floor open for questions, and I have a very, very few specific questions which I will reserve at the very end, but I leave the floor open for various questions, which I'm sure there will be a lot of interest and excitement from this presentation. Questions? Various?
Yep, we start.
So I asked. I would like to know, I mean, with your presentation, there were references to so-called Eastern cultural patterns, elements, but I'm still not 100% sure, is that kind of authority surface, or how deeply does that go? Just that last slide here, when I'm looking for the Eastern elements, I find on the right-hand side, organism, om, right? Obviously this is something, no idea how that fits in, but then going down, there is a yin-yang symbol down there. On the left-hand side, I find nothing. So, you see where I'm coming from. I just, like, you know, is there any beyond that, what you present, anything where the engagement of these different people, including him here, with to what extent did that go?
Yeah, no, it's a nice question. I tried to focus on kind of the playful, loose associations that were typical popular culture, counterculture. So they're kind of ready association. But you have it happening in two ways, or two or three ways. One, you have a group of scholars who are thinking about archetypes. And that's a lot where this is coming from. So you have Joseph Campbell, Eliade, we're really thinking about universal archetypes. And the mandala plays a surprisingly central role in the discussion as the archetype of the whole. And this really comes from Jung, who's also looking for kind of universal archetypes. And so this kind of ready association of different Asian traditions, different world traditions, is part of this, you know, scholastic interest in archetypal forms. And I think also where early scholarship, like in the 60s and 70s, particularly architecture, the mandala is read as a universal archetype, even though, you know, in our history, in architecture, that's kind of, so that's where I think it's on that level that a lot of this is operating. You also have a group of people who are becoming, I think if this is your question, more scholastically interested in Buddhism, Eastern religions, and that's nicely narrated by the kind of movement of the beats across the country. And my favorite image, I don't know, is kind of Jack Kerouac going on the road, ending up in California, hopping off the train, and finally, you know, writing Wake Up Now, you know, and turning to Buddhism. And he becomes a Dharma bum, and then becomes deeply vested in Buddhism, and you get these new institutions like Naropa's and Shambhala, right? Or really, I would say, you know, invested in understanding what Buddhism is and on every level, personal, academic, scholastically. And I think that informs it. I don't think Gordon Ashby, he was not part of it.
Yeah, so I mean, it's going a little bit in that direction where, of course, with the B generation, you have exactly the broad spectrum of some people being more involved, even going so far to learn, for instance, the language in order to understand the basis of the tradition. And some who are like Kerouac, who kind of stayed a kind of Catholic beatnik. So you have the same spectrum.
You have something that you know. Alan Watts is involved with this. I don't know where you put him on that spectrum, maybe he's a bit more serious. Gordon Ashby again was not involved in this, and I thought what was interesting was to see somebody who was self-admittedly not interested in Asian religions, to see how he was able to adopt the form of the mandala consciously, and all of the kind of. And my argument is that brings with it all the baggage of everybody else's thinking.
Thanks, I enjoyed your presentation and just working, thinking about something, so it's really maybe just a comment that I want to make now. And I was thinking in terms of the kind of vision, let's say, that what you've talked about and the people that you've talked about and mentioned represent for, in a sense, for the future. And that it seems in some way, you know, that vision has failed. To me, because the way you began your paper about the kind of things that these people were thinking about, you know, environmental degradation, war, all kinds of crises, where it's happening now as well, right, in a sense. So I wonder, I mean, in general, the kind of question that I'm asking is, where does it actually fail, in a sense? You know, this vision which seems to be so tremendous and inspiring, you know, interconnectedness of human beings with the world and with the universe, etc. But where we wind up, in a sense, is, you know, what Bruno Latour is calling, you know, the Anthropocene, right? In which environment is actually now determined by human beings, totally, in a sense. You know? So I wonder, you know, what happened, and when I listen to your narrative, in the sense that it seems to be so human-centered, right? Even though it is about the world and the universe, it's about human beings and their transformation. And the more you seem to talk about the interconnection, the more the disconnect is actually emphasized, in a sense. And so I'm just kind of trying to explore. I was thinking of this image of the hall of ecology, in which you actually just walk through it. So you're not really a part of it, you're walking through it. Even though it's a wonderful idea to, you know, you're walking through the whole of California, but you're walking through it as an observer. And that seems to be, I don't know, you see this, where does that actually, you know, where is it not, there's some inadequacy of the human-centered notion of ecology and environment, you know, it's, so I don't know how you run it.
This is the recent issue of critical inquiry, which actually took the whole Earth catalog. And it was precisely to think about kind of those historical, how are they getting picked up now? This kind of interest in integrated humans and Anthropocene, and how is that picked up, you know, in this new discourse on, you know, degeneration, etc. I don't have an answer for that, but I guess I wanted to talk about this today because I think how we visualize, how we understand the world is, as you said, and our role in it is part of understanding a solution, or perhaps part of some solution, so perhaps that can be part of what you guys think about. Okay, that's great, I like that.
Yes, please. I have two specific questions. One is, when we understand your presentation, it appears that the central idea is more or less, it's not based on, or it is already understood in the Indian metaphysical understanding, you know, the whole idea of how it comes, the mandalas. I do not get the link and how this is picked up, and secondly, picked up for using these mandalas. That's one difficulty. The second thing is that you mentioned about the Yogananda, Mahesh Yogi or Vivekananda, and how did their thoughts influence this process? That I'm not able to get it. If you could clarify these two.
I'll start with the second one. So,
what is the influence of these people?
So, I guess when they start to come to America, they start to talk about religion as a science, and a science of mind, in a way divorcing it from the idea of a religion as a kind of practice, right? So, and linking it more with an American interest in technology, and science. And that allows it, in my argument, in my sense, I believe, to kind of mix with new technologies and infographics. What I didn't talk about was also, you have the budding of the internet, of new computer technologies, which is about visualizing abstract concepts, and those are all coming out of this idea of a science of mind, and the idea that you could transform the mind through practice in a way that isn't about devotion, but about practice, about transformation. So I think that's where they're really coming in, that, you know, ideas from India, from particularly, are not about any particular religion, but about a universal science of mind. So it's the same, the formal, the idea that the mandala can be a universal archetype is parallel to the idea that religion can be a kind of universal approach to individuation or personal transformation. And that's really where their ideas are kind of coming in. And I think they kind of quite consciously have a rhetoric of that about when they come to America. The second one is where the ideas, I guess what I was trying to show is that they're coming from everywhere. You have life and Time magazine, kind of huge global publications, publishing reviews of the Bhagavad Gita. In the 70s, you have mandalas. I mean, a lot of his images are made just by cutting up life in Time magazine. And so, I guess the fact that somebody like Gordon Ashby pick him up is proof that they were really just in the air. And I think what was unique about California was how much they were in the air and how much all of those different things were coming together. My advisor, actually, Greg Castillo, talks about it as a kind of terroir, or like the kind of flavor of the earth. And California's flavor of the earth at that point was to have science, technology, religions, artists all mixing together. So, I hope that makes sense.
Question. Can I misuse my access to the microphone?
Who's supposed to answer this question?
Oh, yeah, Bobby. Please.
To answer
this,
sir, I would really like to hear more from you about how you are defining counterculture.
Ah, okay, great. And actually, I'd love to hear what you think about that too. The counterculture, I guess, starts with the 50s and the 80s. I love, you asked about history repeating itself. I like to think that history is repeating itself, because in the 1950s, the Beats were called hipsters. And now everybody's called hipsters in San Francisco again. And so I'm hoping that it's going to lead to new generation hippies and kind of rethinking of ecology. But counterculture was this idea that of people who would drop out, who didn't want to be part of the system. They didn't want to go to college, get a job, 9 to 5, work for IBM, work for a big corporation. They wanted to explore life and the world and all the possibilities. And it kind of finds its height in the 1968s in Berkeley in the kind of free speech movement, where this kind of huge protest and all these things break out and against the establishment, against the way things were. Counterculture is really that movement to say we're not going to do things the way they were. But it's really this 1960s, 50s to 70s that it's really a group of people, intellectuals, artists, rethinking those things. And it's largely tied to protests and free speech movements and these different kind of counterculture movements that define themselves as counterculture. I don't know if that answers.
Yeah.
But the whole idea that you would go to San Francisco with no money in your pocket and go live in a commune was so radical in the 50s and 60s, right? That people were just driving around buses and making friends with whoever they met, and it was just unheard of at that time. Yeah.
Wondering if we could, when we call a certain culture as a counterculture, we are creating parallel cultures. We are creating almost like it's like a demarcation as of this. But when we actually see the world as it is, we really can't identify which the culture is, which the counterculture is, because in a sense, so counterculture becomes the culture. Because the culture is it's like reinventing itself, it is becoming a counterculture. So if when we name something like counterculture, are we not like defining culture consequently as a static thing rather than accepting it as a process which is more dynamic in nature? Do you think we have to maybe think forward in that way?
In a nice way, it has a nice callback to your question of how, how do these, where do they break down? Where does the counterculture break down? It's perhaps, because I see that moment when it stops being counterculture and starts being mainstream. I think the history that Gordon Ashby starts his design work with IBM, kind of the biggest, one of the biggest corporations, and then becomes a counterculturalist, and then, Google picks up the same aesthetics and policies within its office, which becomes, was it its own moment countercultural, becomes mainstream. So that, these are part of the cycles. But perhaps that optimism breaks down when it becomes mainstream culture.
Maybe just an example, because you asked, how would you think about counterculture and the subcontinent.
Yeah,
there's so many examples. For example, the Lingayas, in the 12th century, 10th, 12th century, scholars would call it counterculture. Because they talked about the breakdown of caste hierarchies and equality between genders, so on. Which then interestingly becomes its own, caste and becomes exclusive. So this is an example of what you're saying, how we have these cycles, you know, something is countercultural, becomes mainstream, you know.
But I think, you know, in the 70s, you really have these groups are trying to make this mainstream. And so the architects who are taking these graphics and applying them to houses, they want everybody's house, they want the entire world's house to be modeled like that. It's a move away from drop city and trying to take those principles that were learned in the counterculture and make them mainstream. I think at the end they're really, you know, no longer hoping to be counterculture.
Okay, so thanks for your fantastic presentation. Like, I think like it was a topic in our semester. So in our school and in the School of Historical Studies, we also try to bring disciplinary knowledge from different perspective and try to synthesize that and try to see like how really knowledge is being created.
Yeah.
And it was a perfect example, like where you have presented like how ideas were traveling from one location to other, and how the counterculture, which was taking place in California, was drawing from ideas generated in different parts of the world, and they were trying to link religious ideas with different kinds of scientific and technological ideas and techniques to present those ideas in a more different manner. So it was a fantastic presentation. It's like in our class also we have talked about environmental movements and how environmental movements have root in social and political movements that were happening during 1950s and 60s. So at that level one can see the empirical links, but through your presentation one can understand the more nuanced understanding, like how these religious ideas has shaped these kind of counterculture, and how overall in the longer period or in the longer term they have given rise to much more robust environmental understanding and environmental movements. So thank you.
Court National is really involved in the environmental movement, and more than in Eastern religions. And this is a fun story that I he had these organized these block parties where they would paint with chalk on the pavement, and they would bring all their kids and families together, everybody drew it. And one day they got together and they were all drawing and they drew whales on the pavement. So somebody started drawing and turned into a whale. Have you guys heard of the Save the Whales movement in California? It's huge. Anyway, it grew out of that. So that person drew the whale, and they saw the whale, and they fell in love with it, and then they're like, oh, whales, we should save them. And that's where that all came from. So actually, this really was kind of a birth of an ecological movement in the U.S. Yeah.
Sam?
Yeah.
Thanks for
the
very interesting talk. I actually wanted to follow up a little bit on what you were asking, and try to get you to reflect more on sort of the failure. Because I really see a lot of interesting ideas here, but the failure of this sort of perspective, I think, what they were trying to do actually hasn't sort of ended or petered out or people aren't interested anymore. So I'm wondering if you could highlight a couple of reasons. I mean, you're mentioning things about trying to be mainstream, or there seems like there may be some sort of commercialism that sort of crept into this idea. I mean, even the whole of catalog was for sale and stuff. So even now in the U.S. generating a counterculture, it becomes almost immediately co-opted by commercial interests. And maybe that's why in India you feel like there's less counterculture, but actually it's not there, but it's just not commercialized in the same way. So I'm wondering if you can reflect on that sort of broader view. Sort of looking forward and looking maybe in the 90s.
Sure. Well, the people who are involved in this are still deeply kind of invested in it. The architectural diagram at the end was drawn by a name Sim Bender, taught at UC Berkeley, and then was actually the state of California's architect. He won't leave his home anymore because he doesn't want to use the petrol. And he's just so, everything in his house is exactly like the house he drew. So for them, I think they're really still invested. Their kind of efforts haven't stopped, but they're also a bit less optimistic and they're a bit disgruntled. To just see that their ideas weren't picked up, or people didn't listen to them. Again, I think change is hard. This is going to be a rather problem. I think change is hard, and a few people might change, but to kind of make the mass global changes, perhaps the problem is the focus on the individual, perhaps it's the sense of an observer. Maybe it's because it becomes commercialized. You see the same with, a
lot of religious movements become kind of isolated or become catered towards the rich and not to everybody. You know, one of the main, you know, countercultural places is called Eshelon. It was this amazing place on the coast where you could go and, you know, Buckminster Fuller was coming there. Everybody interesting was coming to Eshelon and has these beautiful hot tubs over the water. And it was just an amazing place for food and water. It's now over $300 a night. Nobody who's revolutionary can go there anymore. It's only for people who are really rich to spend the night there. Part of it was just cost. I think, you know, the cost of running a place like that. Part of it was demand. They had an accident, for example, the hot tubs fell into the water and they had to rebuild them. When they designed them, I guess they didn't hire a good architect, and the refurbishment was so expensive that in order to pay for it, they had to raise the cost of everything. Again, I think the demands of life are hard, and what was so amazing about the counterculture and its failures is to, at one point, say it's not worth it anymore. To say, I'm going to go get a job, all of those things. Another failed kind of dream was the University of California system, in a way. If you look at, that used to be, that's where I go to school, but when in the 60s and 70s it was cheaper, people spent more money on their books than they did on tuition. And now that's no longer the case, people leave with debt. But if you leave university with no debt, the world's really, you say, you're a waster, right? It's so much easier to go and explore the world for 5 years if you have no debt than it is if you have debt. You're going to go right away to school, you know, you're going to get a job because I need to pay back my debt. So those things, I think, are about moments when it fails.
Thank you for wonderful talk. I heard about 45 years ago or so, many hippies came to India, not only to Puri or not only to Goa, but also Bodh Gaya or Rajagir as well. And I heard they lived in Japanese temple near Shanti Stupa put together. They read the Siddhartha of Hermann Hesse, and they were singing together around the fire, they are drinking or sometimes doing drugs or like that. So you can find any significance of Buddhism other than mandala in Holder's catalog or the works of Buddha and Ashby.
Sure. Less important Ashby, but in the Holder's catalog it's full of Buddhism. It's full of things brought back from trips actually. Books written about it. Everything from literary works written about it to travel narratives to little objects brought back from India. But I think more it was the culture of sitting around the fire and doing drugs and singing religious chants that they brought back. And that was not, I think, not necessarily Indian, but that was this kind of weird amalgamation that happened in places like Nalanda. But hippies went to India for two things. That was drugs and religion, so I shouldn't say that. Thank you. I want to say it's been really nice to share this.
Yeah,
we'll have
sure.
More chance.
Can I please use my
is there any link between this and the Freemason Society?
I don't know. But there was many of the same images in this kind of. You could trace another kind of history of the appropriation of different images from different traditions. From Freemasons, or maybe more pressing in India, would be the Theosophists, the Theosophical Society, where you really start to get this grouping of new images together. And that becomes the basis for people like Carl Jung's text on alchemy and things like that. So that's another more specific history of the mandala as it kind of goes around the world.
So,
the
still
open?
Yeah. I was waiting till now so that I can more of answers and get some sense for my own question. I just want to know that how much of religion and how much of science was there in this whole process? Because you were saying the context from where it, all this movement came up, it was a religion and sciences coming together. So what do you think, which one was more or maybe more?
I think it was really the kind of unusual combination of the two. Like the two were really kind of vibrantly going around together. If you just think about it spatially, in LA you had all of these kind of religious communes right next to aerospace technology centers. They were just right next to each other, and they were just mixing
the same people who are interested in, you know, new meditation practices were also interested in computers, like computers' ability to, you know, map out abstract ideas and make these kind of connections across space and time. And so they were, and you know, Einstein, you know, a lot of, I've seen a lot of pictures of Einstein in Tibetan monasteries. And so you have a lot of, it's just happening all together.
Do you think the religion also got a new definition
in the science? I think both were inspected. I think religion got a new, you know, there were new approaches to religion because of science. Donald Lopez wrote an interesting book called Scientific Buddha, which talks about an interesting tradition history of the Buddha becoming kind of more and more scientific. And then, but science also, I think, was deeply, there was new, actually people thought about science in ways that they might not have if they hadn't been exposed to other forms of religion. I think that was also part of it. There's an artist, really fun artist, with these kind of light mandalas, early animations of mandalas. And his morning was described as waking up and reading the Tao Te Ching, doing some yoga, then, you know, reading about astrophysics, and then doing some yoga, and then repositioning. You know, he had this war machine, like this old military machine that they could tinker with in the afternoon. That was his day. And that was his kind of average day.
Sorry, I'll just misuse my location to the mic now. One very specific, which I think I'm reading wrong, but just to clarify. When you talk about the whole of environment that Africa creates, I know of Africa's work more in the context of design and exhibition histories, slightly. But I'm just trying to think whether, I mean, and in line with the question that Anita was raising, that whether, I mean, when he's making an amalgam of things in the whole of exhibition, not making it the traditional encyclopedic evolutionary modern form, when he's putting the human in that, whether there is a sense that the human sort of just walked past it and is not a part of the exhibitionary space itself, or whether I'm reading too much into that.
I think he was saying you would see yourself in it. There was one room where he kind of put, California is well known for its redwood trees, it's really huge. One room is entirely redwood, so you go in to the redwood room. Together in that. So I think it's not so much that you walk past it, that it doesn't really show, but then you really see, feel yourself.
So you are part of the exhibitionary frame.
Exactly. And even I think the use of kind of, there was this tree where you could see the other person on the other side, so you could imagine that as you're moving through it, it's all kind of one-to-one scale, so you would imagine you'd see the other person on the other side, and there'd be kind of dialogue with the people moving through.
The second and more quick question, and this is like probably I'm getting bonkers, but I'm also trying to think of the way in which it might or might not have anything to do with this kind of imagination of one's location in the universe and the images of the Earth, obviously. There is, of course, a way in which it has to do with the mandalas and the mandala world and this world of Eastern philosophy and religion. But does it have any referential citation point to the, let's say, the early, often very imaginative maps of the world kind of thing that come out and deep geological maps that come out and talk about laws and lost spaces and the maps of maps of the world that include both the present continental borders as well as what would be seen as the deep lost as the lost spaces within the deep geological time and those kind of images.
Again, not so much in words actually,
but in the
definitely. Next to it, like old maps of the world, old cosmological maps. And then there was a group, the neighbor of Lauren Ashby, just down the street was Lawrence Cochran, and they did a place called Sea Ranch. And as part of the process of designing it, they made what they call this kind of shell of time, and it mapped that site, which was built then in the 60s, in like billions of years. And so there was a sense of understanding these projects within a larger scope of time.
Any questions? Thanks, Padma. Thanks again.
That's wonderful.